Welcome back, everybody, to your next episode of Reptile Reality. Yeah, this is a much-awaited event for me. I'm on vacation. I haven't had a vacation in over a year. So I'm coming at you right now from Indonesia. We're on the reptile farm outside of Jakarta. It's a real special place for me, you know, not only because I get all my animals from here, but this is a really beautiful place. It's almost like a botanical garden. Walk through here and kind of meander through the paths and whatnot, and it's a really beautiful place. Now, this is really special for me, not only because I'm actually here, but because 2016 marks the 20-year anniversary of DMExotics. I stumbled into this by accident. I started as a small-time breeder, hobbyist. I ended up becoming a business, and 20 years later, I'm still here. And I'm actually, you know, I've jumped up ahead quite a bit. Now I'm supplying the pet stores that I used to buy from. I'm supplying wholesale distributors and everything else. So I really appreciate all of your support. I owe it all to you guys. I try to be as patient as possible, answer all emails, talk to as many people as I can at the expos and whatnot. So it's pretty interesting stuff. I'm excited. We just got here. When my supplier knows that I'm coming out, he usually stashes away some pretty badass animals. So let's go check this out. I'm really excited. So this is really cool. A really big surprise, a melanistic water monitor. It's a little baby, it's a chunky little guy. Has black nails, black tongue, fantastic condition. This is one of the creatures that's gonna be arriving by the end of the year. But you know, these are the surprises that you come across when you come out here to the farm and you just never know what you're gonna see, kind of tucked away. Good stuff is sometimes left here to be a surprise for later when I arrive. This is definitely a surprise. It's a melanistic water monitor, really cool. Another really cool surprise here on the farm is baby sulfur water monitor. Now, I'll tell you what, I've gotten some of these animals off the farm as babies and I've sold them to my customers and they've turned into some outstanding adults with lots and lots of color. These bands and stuff will start to increase in color. The animals will start to get really light over time, but my supplier gets really good ones, and this one's very healthy. You can tell by the base of the tail there. So it's another really nice quality animal. Should be arriving by the end of the year. So sulfur water monitor, good stuff. And here on the farm, baby Dumerils monitors. Now these little guys as hatchlings are something else. They're really, really colorful. Unfortunately, these orange heads will fade over time. Some people say that it's probably like a mimic, like a maybe a coral snake mimic or something along those lines. Try to scare predators off when they're small and vulnerable like this. But you know, coming across little hatchlings like that, it's very rare in the hobby to see little guys like this. And they're just cute as can be. And Dumerils monitors, I mean, you can't ask for a better monitor as a captive. They're really, really great captives. And it's one of the first monitors that I ever had when I was a youngster. I was about 14 years old, and I had a pretty big wild-caught one. And it was a really cool pet. But anyway, baby Dumerils monitors. And another thing that a lot of you guys are asking me about is blue tree monitors. This one's in really good condition, also available to me for the next shipment. So I'll probably try to get a few of these guys in. I know people are looking for them. One of the benefits keeping native animals in your native country, you can keep them in outdoor enclosures like this. even though it's getting ready to probably pour down some rain, we lost the sun. But under normal circumstances, the sun is shining through the screen, and you know, the animals get all the sunlight that they could ask for. This is obviously my favorite room that we're digging out of right now. This is an albino Homolopsis bucata. It's a puff-faced water snake. I've seen quite a few albinos and different sorts of morphs, I guess you could say, but this one is really, really nice quality. The bands are very prominent compared to a lot of the albinos that I've seen in the past, but it's very, very nice. It looks like a female. And I know that it's been here on the farm for a while because I was sent a photo of this animal quite a few months ago. So it's here and it's doing well. And you can tell by looking at it that it's feeding and doing really good. But another animal that's available to me. So see how it goes. But really nice stuff. And for those of you that know me, another one of my crowd pleasers here, Melanistic Pitaeus carinatus. This is a very, very rare animal. I have a couple at home. This one's in shed, but it's a very, very nice animal. So, it's a nice day here on the farm, I have to say. Cool, cool, cool. Love to see this animal after it sheds. It's gonna be something else. All right, good stuff. And here's some baby boiga, some of my favorite baby mangroves. These guys were hatched here on the farm. And these are dendrophila, not like the Malaysian stuff that I've been dealing in lately, but a lot of people are working with the dendrophila from Indonesia. And so now we're getting into the things also that I really like. These are scrub pythons. These are Ambon scrubs, or Malucan as the trade calls them, but these were collected from Ambon. Really nice specimens. These animals look really, really good. I'm definitely gonna have these in the next shipment. Beautiful snakes. Haven't seen these around that much anymore. They're just not common like they used to be. But, and also with that, you know, getting really nice high quality animals is also very difficult. They're being collected from different areas. You know, it's not like they used to be. They used to be really, really pretty and easy to come by, but the animals have since, you know, the localities and whatnot, the differences have been darker and darker and darker, and these animals are not those. These are like the old style stuff that I'm used to seeing from way back. Really pretty. This is nice quality here. Definitely going to be on my shipment coming back. I'm stoked to see these here on the farm. And here's a Jayapura barneck. You know, these are the ones that everybody is after, especially the small size like this. They tend to do really, really well. Just kind of get them over that first hump, make sure they take their first meals and that, and they tend to do really well. These Jayapuras are really nice. They start to like almost exanthic look like this, and then they also are some really vibrant gold animals. But these are great. Whenever I'm offered these, I always take them. I have a small little collection of these at home for myself personally, and any surplus I offer, of course. So that's a Jayapura barnet. So here's another Jayapura with a lot more size to it. Getting more into the gold coloration, but again, some of these are, they are really, really gold color, really pretty. But that's good stuff, man. I really like to jump on these when I have the opportunity. A lot of times it's the southerns, the Maraoke stuff, that's the most common. Some people like them, some people don't. I really like them. I like the docile nature of the Maraokes. Most of them, the majority of them, I guess I should say, tend to be pretty docile and easy to work around. These guys, the Jayapuras, are a little bit different, but they're really appealing, really pretty animals. So try to bring in all I can, which isn't many. They're not available like they used to be in big numbers. Now it's really hit and miss, but it looks like this particular shipment is going to be pretty good. I'm seeing a little bit of number of some of the things that I'm really after that I don't get offered in great numbers. So anyway, it's very promising. So here's a water python. These are here from Indonesia. Obviously the fuscas do occur in Australia, but they also do occur here in Indonesia, and this is proof to it right here. We do have a quota on these guys, and I might actually bring some of these in. These are really cool. These guys eat like crazy, and they breed really well. They breed actually kind of at a young age. They grow real fast. So kind of a really interesting snake that I haven't seen in quite some time. But again, possible for the next shipment. Here's kind of another oddity. These are euonite. These animals are not exported at this time. The wild population is actually unknown, so they do not allow any of these animals. There's no quota for export. But these are both males in my hand here, and really pretty. Actually, they're quite rare in the trade as well. And these, obviously, I will state it again, these animals will not attempt to be imported into the U.S., but just something that's real interesting here on the farm that you don't get to see every day. Cool. So here's some more euonite. These are a lot smaller in size. It's kind of interesting that they start out and their shell here is really, really spiky. But these are smaller guys. They range up into a little bit bigger. Spikes are still present at this size, and then kind of an intermediate size, the spikes are still present, but they're starting to actually form a nice roundish design there shell. So these are more euonite. These are not here for any sort of trade purposes. These are actually going to be going into some parental breeding stock, you know, for conservation, that sort of thing. They're actually moving off the farm and going to an actual facility dedicated towards turtle breeding. Now these here, these are Forstens tortoises. This is something else. I've never seen one so small like that. Now there is still a small quota left on these. Of course, to import into the United States, they have to be 4 inches. So probably looking at more smaller size like these. When you get them small like this, they do really, really well. The adults are a little bit hit and miss, but the small ones seem to be real aggressive feeders, very active, but really beautiful. Some of the shells here are, like this animal right here, that shell is just fantastic. All the scutes are perfect. Just the design here, the color spacing in between the black and the yellow is really nice. So these are Forstens tortoises. I think I have 10 left on my quota, so we're gonna get those in before the permits expire. So this is for all the turtle and tortoise fanatics. There is that stuff here on the farm. Again, not all of it is for the pet trade by any means, but some of it is, and it's really interesting, especially to me. You know, I'm a snake guy, so. All right, cool, move on. So these are Key Island skinks, Tiliqua gigas kiensis. These are the adults, and there's a lot of variation between the colors of the adults. This one's obviously kind of a greener color. This one has a little lighter coloration. But there's a lot of variation between the adults, and there's a good number of adult animals on the farm. And believe it or not, these babies were just born here. These are baby kiensis. Now, a lot of people are going to look at these and say that, no, these are just regular blue-tongued skinks. Who are you kidding? They go through quite a color change as they grow, and these were born here to these adults. These are pure baby kiensis. So it's just kind of interesting. A lot of the endemic animals here, lots of variation, lots of confusion, but this is what's going on here at the farm. It's pretty cool, interesting stuff. So here's another black dragon. This one's a little bigger. You know, when you start with them from when they're small, a water monitor can be a really mellow animal, really mellow pet. These haven't been worked with at all. They've been here on the farm, and they don't get too much interaction, but it's a badass animal right here. So that's a black dragon. It's a melanistic water monitor. So anyway, it's pretty good stuff, black dragon. This is a really good day on the farm. We're seeing all kinds of really cool stuff. All right. Kind of cool about this place, you get a little bit hungry, snacks are all over the place. Snack it right off the tree. So here on the farm, obviously they do venomous as well. I'm in California. My legislators and lawmakers are very, very concerned for my safety, therefore I'm not allowed to have these in California. But this is a Sumatran pit viper. This is a female. Really, really beautiful snake. I'm gonna pull a male out next to show you guys the difference. It's pretty dramatic difference, but really, really beautiful snake. And somewhat mild-mannered as well. These are an arboreal ambush type predator. So here on top of this female, this is a fully grown adult male Sumatran pit viper. The size difference is pretty tremendous. And the pattern, of course, also there's a difference, but the size is pretty remarkable between the male and the female. So, but hey, as long as he can get the job done, that's the way nature has intended it. And here's another venomous. It's quite rare in the hobby as well, from northern Sumatra. This is a purple pit viper. The Latin name is Trimerosaurus purpureo maculata. Beautiful snake, and this one is quite a bit different in attitude. Struck a bunch at us with the hooks and things, but you know, again, when you have tools and stuff and keep these animals at a distance, it's pretty safe. Knowing the animals, how they're going to react, and that sort of thing, kind of keep everything at a distance with your tools. Not do anything stupid. Things are usually okay. But that's a really pretty snake. Awesome. So here's another difference between the pit vipers, especially size, but also this time a lot of color differentiation. This is a Wagler's pit viper. This is an adult male. Green animal, has these little rust and white flecks going down the back. Small guy, very pretty in its own right, very beautiful snake. And then this right here on this tree, we brought out one of the adult female Wagler's. Now this one might be in shed. There is a lot of color variation too among adults of these animals. They're very, very beautiful. And again, we have that gigantic size difference. I mean, it's really something else. But the heads on these guys are very, very impressive. I love how the eyes are camouflaged so well in all this scalation here. There's a big, bulky head. Really, really cool looking. Those gigantic pits there, obviously why they're called pit vipers, heat sensing pits. And obviously another arboreal ambush predator. You can see how well this snake is navigating with this branch. They'll find a nice perching area and then they'll just sit and hang out and ambush. So here's a really cool example. These are both green pit vipers. The blue one here is Insularis. This is the one that recently got the big write-up in the Herp Nation article. This is the one that occurs on Komodo, but it also occurs to the east on Timor, and it ranges all throughout. But you know, I mean, that's a blue snake right there. I mean, it's the real deal. There's no Photoshop. We're on video, but pretty snake. Thank you all for watching. I hope you guys enjoyed that. You know, it's really rare to get an inside look at a reptile farm in Indonesia. There's not that many farms. There's only about 5 legitimate farms. That particular one is the biggest, and we're really close friends and obviously good customers of the owner there. And really lucky he allows us to come in and video kind of whatever we want and sort of share it with everybody. So I hope that sheds a little bit of light on the whole farm issue in Indonesia. Now, after we left the farm, we spent 2 weeks in West Papua. We had a really exciting time. It was quite an adventure, very far off the beaten path. So those episodes are coming out next. Subscribe, and you'll get all the updates as soon as they come out. Hope everybody has a great holiday. And again, remember 2016, 20-year anniversary of DMExotics. Really proud of that. So anyway, thanks for watching, and we will see you again very soon. Take care.